silence. In this very moment, there is that more powerful presence called God, expressing everywhere, through everything and everything, as everyone, as everything. I know the truth that this perfection is expressed. This divine being is expressed in and as each and every one of us and everyone around us. And I know that each of us lives and moves and dwells and expresses God. I know in the very depths of my heart and in my mind and in the very body that I live in, God is expressing. And I know that in the mind and the heart and in the body of every person here, that God is fully present. And where God is, there's nothing but perfection, period. I know that this service is done in perfection. It is done perfectly. The reading is perfect. The message is perfect. The people here are perfect. Our fabulous Dan, who is our chief music officer, expresses the divine perfection through him. That Holly expresses the truth of God through her. That Ken expresses the expression of God through his beautiful playing. That everyone here so fully and completely expresses God, that it's done in perfection. It is done, and I am grateful. And I know that this is done in mind, and it is done in form. And so it is.
And so it is.
Yeah.
Are we ready? Okay, good morning and welcome to Center for Spiritual Living Metro, a place where souls are nurtured and people's lives are transformed through the science of mind, philosophy, and practicing our principles. My name is Reverend Trish Hall, and it is my privilege to be your spiritual leader. I welcome all here in the sanctuary this morning and all our viewers at home who are seeing us live stream. We are located at Arlington Arts Center, 3550 Wilson Boulevard, Arlington, Virginia. Thank you all for all of your financial support. And for those at home, we make it really easy for you to contribute as well. Simply go to cslmetro.org, and on the home page, for that matter, I think it's on every page, in the upper right-hand corner, there's a box that says donate. Please do, and thank you. You make it possible for us to live stream. You make it possible for us to be here at the Arlington Arts Center. And so thank you for your generosity, and off we go. So today, we're talking about, are you listening or jumping to conclusions? Now, I get a lot about, because you're at church, you know, you gotta be honest. Okay. Can anyone here claim that they really, truly stay 100% present with the person they're talking to? I'm so glad you're honest. It really helps a lot to know that we are together in this, because what happens is part of it is on the automatic side, and that is how we learn is to link our current experience to something that has happened. So it is quite natural for us to take in what is going on and link it. That's good. That's important for you to learn. Okay, what happens for most of us is we link it. That prompts another memory, and we go chasing that memory, and if we're really honest about it, we realize that we have been gone from that current conversation for hopefully not too long, but in most cases we can't even say how long we've been gone. All we know is, oh my, that mouth is still going and I haven't heard a word since I went off on my tangent. And so our ability to focus in the presence of someone here in the physical world is a lot about whether or not we can focus on our spiritual path, whether or not we can take that time away and meditate, because I would assume that those who are also were honest about it, if you were honest about your meditation tends to be, I'm in the stillness, and like the seagull, shiny, or like the dog, red, or whatever, then all of a sudden we are all over the place. And then we think, ah, yes, I will return. So when we practice being present with the people that we're with, and we practice, it helps our meditation. When we practice in meditation, acknowledging, yup, that was a thought, I'm here. Yup, that was a thought, here. Then we grow that ability. We expand our ability. Instead of what happens when we're in conversation is we make assumptions about what the person is going to say next. We're already, especially if the person is inclined to speak slowly, and when they speak slowly, we're yards ahead of them, not just a moment or two ahead of them. And so one of the important things to remember is how listening affects us. And one of the ways in which listening affects us when we're with someone else is we assume if they are present with us, if they care. In fact, for most people, there is such an intermingling of caring and the sense of being loved, that they cannot be pulled apart. If you think if someone is not willing to be present with you, if someone is not willing to be in your company, or is already jumping to conclusions and having something more to say and keeping this whole thing, okay, we don't feel loved. We don't feel like someone cares. We don't feel like that we even matter, because they have gone off on their tangent, or they're overriding, or they're trying to alter, or they, you know, they've got all this other stuff going. And so our feeling of being loved is inextricably intertwined with whether or not someone is willing to be present with us. One of the reasons why it's so important, you know, if somebody's ill, or if somebody is having a challenge, that we don't try to question, we don't ask, we simply are present. Total focus, here we go. And if our mindset is, share with me, please, let me know, let me in, let me know more about you. That when that causes our heart to open, because we're not asking, tell me the data about you. Who cares about the data about you? I care about you. I care about what is in your heart. With Frank's reading, I care because I want to connect with who you are as the expression of your mind. I know what you are as the expression of your mind. We all are. We can't avoid it. Okay. But who you are is how you are showing up in the world. And so for me to give you the gift of my presence is for me to be with you. For you to give me that sense that I matter in the world is for you to have those moments with me where they are simply gifts of together. And so often we say don't make assumptions, but there is one exception that I want to make, and that is if we assume something negative about somebody, that's projected. They know it, they sense it. That if we go through the world with a great anticipation and expectancy of the grandeur of the God presence, of the awesomeness of this person that I'm with, it shifts how they can show up. And this has been scientifically documented as well as in our own experience. When we greet somebody knowing, oh, look at them, then all of a sudden there is this space of grace that is granted to them so that they can be their best yet to be. They can be more than they may have ever imagined that they could be, because our greeting of them, our assumption of them in their awesomeness, grants that space. And so Capra declared, physicists explore levels of matter and mystics explore levels of mind. What they have in common is that both levels lie above the ordinary sense of perception. And so when that's one of those where when we try to define it, and this is part of why we get into this, okay, I'm off on my tangent, you know, when it would be better if I was present with you, is that we by habit want to make something make sense. We by habit want to reason our way through it. We want to put it in a box, because if we can put it in a box, then we know what we know about it. Only we don't. We think we know what we know about it, and it's because we've made assumptions. We have taken this fragment, this fragment, this fragment, and when we have taken those fragments, then all of a sudden we build our story, and our story is not even necessarily anything to do with the person that we're with. about love. We didn't, you know, the others are all about, hey, how do we get together on this thing? We're on this path together, like it or not. But so we have this opportunity, instead of focus on separation, to focus on oneness, instead of focusing on hate, we have to focus on love. And that's kind of a challenge sometimes, because the proximity can be blinding. Those beliefs, you know, if we've allowed them to take up residence in our brain, how close those thoughts of separation are, or those thoughts of hatred, of violence, of all the things that we see in the world around us. Now there, by the way, is a separate sidebar, and that is when we hear in the media of violence, and we allow our uncontrolled thought to take off from that, where do we go? I will not even go there with you. I only ask the question, where do we go if we allow that to come in and take up residence? Instead, when we hear it as a call to prayer, hear it as a call to affirmation, that we know the illimitable power of love, that love is the most powerful force in the universe, and so we can take what appears in front of us and say, ah, yes, I am not limited by that perception. I know that there is, within all of it, there is God. Within all of it, there is love. And going back to how do we relate to people, and we give that space of grace that allows them to be more than they have ever been before. When we do that with a circumstance, we allow that circumstance to be transmuted. Instead of ganging up on it with all of the others that get tangled into the hate and the violence and everything else, we can say, ah, yes, in this space, there is possibility. There is pure potentiality. There is love. And so, I'm paraphrasing a thing that Mark Nepo, who, by the way, is one of my favorite authors, said is, there are no wrong turns. There are only unexpected paths. And just take that for a moment and think about the number of times you thought this was your path, this was the direction you were going to go, and all of a sudden it turned into muck and mire and other stuff, which also starts with S. Okay, so as it has turned into that, you took a detour. How many times has that detour opened you up to possibilities you didn't even imagine before that? And that those possibilities in opening you up then provided new opportunities for growth, for celebration, for, you know, just all kinds of things. Okay, we can make that part of that heart opening that says, I'm ready for the detours. I'm fine with the detours. I'm fine where I'm, where my path apparently is leading at the moment. And detours are opportunities. Detours have different things to see. Imagine, at least for me, the incredible order of life being one foot in front of the other. I cannot imagine. I now, part of it is I have a short attention span, and so, I cannot imagine a predictable life. If all of it was predictable, some people are what they want. What they think they want is a totally predictable life. And what they have done by having a totally predictable life is put on blinders, if not a blindfold. And so they miss the excitement, they miss the creativity, they miss out on so much. And so our founder, our spiritual leader, Dr. Ken Gordon, who, by the way, will be here in September as our featured presenter at the annual retreat. a son-in-law who had read every possible self-improvement, everything that anybody put out about how, you know, you change your life, change your thinking, change your life, all these others. And he was deadly with it because he would use it as a battering, you know, a bashing stick of some sort, because he knew, but he had not embodied, he had not embraced, it was not his, and so there was no feeling about it. All there was raw knowledge, and raw knowledge does not manifest. Raw knowledge and thought plus engagement, feeling, and full embodiment. Now, another word that we use for that often is congruency. Because if our mind knows something and our body is not experiencing it, then what's happening is a disconnect. We are not congruent. When we put the two together, when we have the thought, when we have the feeling, when we have the knowing, when we have the passion, and we pull it all together, things pop. They just do, because we're out of the way. So when we are with that idea, then we are literally unstoppable. So it requires openness, it requires knowledge, it requires passion and feeling. And when we put all of that together, then we rise to our best yet to be. We get to have those magnificent experiences. We get to celebrate the weird detours. We get to go wherever and be whatever and celebrate the moment and be present with those along the way. Maybe thinking in terms of, this is my greatest teacher, and it may be somebody on the street. This is my greatest teacher, and it may be somebody that's a great learning teacher. Or maybe it's somebody who's down and out, or maybe it's somebody who needs my help. This moment is my learning moment, whatever this moment is. And so I invite you now to get centered. If it's comfortable, close your eyes, not required, because we're just going to contemplate something. And it comes from the Science of Mind textbook. And I shared it in a prayer just Saturday. Okay. Ernest Holmes said, by some inner mystic presence, I was told to live and love, to laugh and be glad. I was told to be still and know of the one almighty power in and through all. I was told to let that power work through and in me. I believed that voice, and I received my gift. say,